Thank you. Good morning and welcome to the 22nd meeting of the Constitution Europe External Affairs and Culture Committee in 2024. We have one agenda item this morning to take evidence as part of our pre-budget scrutiny on funding for culture. And we are joined this morning by Angus Robertson, MSP, Cabinet Secretary for the Constitution, External Affairs and Culture. And the Cabinet Secretary is joined this morning by Shona Riach, Director of External Affairs and Culture at the Scottish Government, and can invite the Cabinet Secretary to make an opening statement.
Thanks very much, Convene. Good morning to all of you, and thanks for the invitation to the committee today to discuss the Scottish Government funding for culture in 2025-26 as part of your pre-budget scrutiny. And I'm delighted to see some familiar faces across the table. Extend warm welcome to new members of the committee. Thank them in advance for their contributions to the invaluable work of the committee. I know that for all of us in the committee room today, we're here because we are passionate supporters of the culture sector. We value the artists, the creative producers, the cultural workers who generate so much for our local and for our national economy. Of course, their contribution and the value of culture goes beyond mere pounds and pence. Culture and creative expression are the very essence of who we are as individuals, as distinctive communities, and as a nation. Cultural participation and engagement is fundamental to the well-being of people across Scotland and vital in making meaningful connections with other nations on the world stage. As Culture Secretary, I regularly speak to many of the cultural organisations who I know are ploughing a significant amount of their time and resource into responding to the challenges of the much-changed operating landscape we find ourselves in post-pandemic and post-Brexit. I was particularly appreciative of the recent dialogue I had with the trade union representatives from the Scottish Trade Union Congress, the Scottish Playwrights Association and Equity about how the ongoing pressure is affecting their members, and I was pleased to be able to update them on the progress being made by the Culture Fair Work Task Force. I'm hopeful that the new administration at Westminster heralds a new era of collaboration across the four nations of the United Kingdom, but we cannot escape the fact that the cost of living crisis and inflationary pressures on top of already depleted public finances makes for a challenging fiscal outlook across the board. And the Scottish Government has been forced to make significant in-year savings and more to ensure it can reach a path to balance in the current and successive years. I fully appreciate that the sector is very concerned about public funding for culture and what the immediate and longer term future holds. The sense of uncertainty and deep frustration has been underlined in the written submissions and oral evidence gathered by the committee to date, and I want to thank everybody who's taken time to articulate their concerns and share their experiences as well as their thoughts about what future support for the sector should look like. I want to reassure the sector and the committee from the outset that I'm doing everything within my power as the Cabinet Secretary for Culture to get the best budget settlement I can for culture and the arts. As set out in our Culture Strategy for Scotland, this government recognises the intrinsic value of culture and the transformational impact it can have on people right across Scotland, and that is why the First Minister restated our commitment to increase funding for culture so that it is £100 million more annually by 2028-29. This cross-cabinet commitment has enabled more than £15 million of additional monies to be released to the culture sector already in 24-25, which not only included an additional £6.6 million to Creative Scotland, enabling their open fund for individuals to reopen, but also provided an uplift for those who care for our national collections and our national performing companies. I know that media reporting and wider speculation has fuelled fears that the plans for an additional £100 million for the sector may not come to fruition, but I want to put on record here so it is absolutely clear. This Scottish Government has the utmost confidence in the culture sector and is committed to providing significantly more funding for the sector on a cumulative basis. I believe that we have turned a corner in public funding for culture, and our aim is for the culture budget in 2025-26 to substantially increase as a second step towards fulfilling our overall funding commitment towards an additional £100 million annually. As a government, we recognise that it is absolutely fundamental that we have stable and supportive financial arrangements in place for the sector, and we remain committed to supporting the sector to fulfil its enormous potential. The trajectory for the new Creative Scotland multi-year funding programme is positive, with the potential for many, many more cultural organisations to benefit. I'm engaged in discussions with Creative Scotland about how best to navigate the operational challenges presented by the timings of the UK Chancellor of the Exchequer's budget statement on the 30th of October. It's only once we have the necessary practical assurance around the Scottish Government's budget for 25-26 that we'll be able to set our commitments for the culture portfolio. We're bringing forward our budget on the 4th of December, which will then be subject to the normal parliamentary processes for approval, and I have written to the Chair of Creative Scotland this morning, copied to the committee to that effect. I understand that Creative Scotland is likely to delay announcing the outcome of the multi-year funding process until there is confirmation on the 25-26 budgetary position. The Scottish Government will, of course, work closely with Creative Scotland in supporting the sector through this process. It's clear that now, more than ever, we have to make sure that every pound of public funding for culture is wisely invested for maximum sector impact, and that support available from across the public, private and third sectors is also enhanced where possible, so that together we can strengthen culture and create the conditions for culture to thrive, one of the central ambitions set out in a culture strategy for Scotland. As I said before, I want to ensure that the sector can sustain, develop and ultimately thrive and innovate, but that will take time, investment and dedication to achieve. It will also require a reprioritisation of activity, and the Scottish Government had set out in the recent programme for government those key strategic actions that it believes will best sustain the sector going forward. This work will include a review of existing support for the sector to inform future funding models, as well as exploring other ways in which the Scottish Government can work with partners to grow the overall funding pot for culture, diversify funding streams, and support the sector in ways that go beyond funding to include, for example, organisational and business support. This work will help the sector navigate current and future challenges and make the most of opportunities for collaborative working. The wider review will include a full review of Creative Scotland as the main distributor of funding for the culture and creative sector in Scotland. As you know, Creative Scotland was established as the lead body for the arts, screen and creative industries in 2010, and it's important that its remit and functions are reviewed to ensure it is continuing to meet the needs of the culture sector in a much altered delivery landscape. The Scottish Government is committed to continuous improvement across all of our public bodies and maximising the impact of public sector support for the culture sector, and the review is a key component of that work. I'm delighted at the number of local festivals, as well as our nationally high-profile festivals of international renown, have expressed an interest in getting involved in the planned festivals partnership, and I know that my officials are currently reaching out to a number of those festivals and other individuals and organisations with an interest in festivals more broadly to shape the membership and remit of the partnership in the first instance. The partnership will support collaborative working and active learning across festivals where possible and ensure that the full potential of all of our festivals is realised locally, nationally and internationally. Scottish Government remains committed to improving Scotland's public services as an investment in Scotland's future health and well-being, equality and prosperity by strengthening future support for the culture sector. As well as the review of Creative Scotland, we're continuing our public sector reform work with Historic Environment Scotland to maximise income growth, as well as working with our national collections bodies to explore alternative ways of working. In conclusion, Convener, we'll continue to work with partners to ensure all public, private and third sector investment available is used to deliver the maximum benefit for communities and organisations across Scotland. I look forward to working with the committee members and with colleagues across the chamber to realise that ambition, and hope that you will, perhaps most importantly, support our planned increase to culture funding through the parliamentary process in due course. Thank you, Convener, and members of the committee.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary, and thank you for that detailed opening statement. The culture sector has, since COVID, experienced a particularly hard time, as is evidenced in our previous sessions. I think the perfect storm was the phrase that was used a couple of years ago. And what we're hearing from people is a lack of confidence. And in-year budget changes, the closure of the Open Fund, all of these things have impacted on that. So for the budget, what are your priorities to increase confidence in the sector going forward?
So the most important thing that can boost people's confidence is delivering on the commitments that have been made. And the commitment that has been made is that there should be an uplift in culture funding which will be cumulative and will top £100 million as an annual increase by 28-29. This is the first year of that increase. More than £15 million of that additional £100 million has been dispersed already. And I'm, as you would expect, in the run-up to a budget, I'm very involved in discussions internally within the Scottish Government with colleagues, but have had discussions with Creative Scotland at a senior management level last week to discuss how we make sure that we are able to deliver the maximum amount of money that we can as part of that uplift towards the £100 million. Now, this isn't an abstract thing, and it's not just a matter of confidence, although confidence is really important. I acknowledge that. Would people wish it to be quicker? Absolutely. I wish it to be as quick as possible as well. But we have a very, very important opportunity coming soon, which I think will profoundly improve much of the culture and arts sector in Scotland, which is the delivery of multi-annual year funding. Now, I appreciate that everybody on the committee will know what that is. Perhaps not everybody watching your deliberations might. And what it is it will change the way in which cultural organisations are funded so that they only have clarity for one financial year at the present time, but in future they will have clarity over a number of years, which will mean that they can get on with their core task, which is cultural and artistic, rather than financial and bureaucratic. And Creative Scotland has been working very hard behind the scenes as part of a significant change programme to deliver multi-annual year funding, which has been supported by the Scottish Government, was a proposal of my party and is now being delivered. And I think I'm right in saying that Scotland is going to be the first part of the United Kingdom to introduce multi-annual year funding to our culture and creative sector. So it's a really big programme, change programme, beneficial programme. At the present time, there are just over 100 regularly funded organisations funded by Creative Scotland. Creative Scotland, in the last round, had more than 250 cultural organisations applying for multi-annual year funding. And I would like to see the maximum number of artistic organisations receive multi-annual year funding. And if it's anything close to that, that is more than a doubling of Scottish cultural organisations receiving multi-annual year funding. So, as committee members, I think, will appreciate, there's a huge prize here to be delivered if we can secure the increase in funding. Now, that is dependent on having the resources, so that's why we await the UK government budget. I will try and be as persuasive as I can with Scottish Government colleagues about and through the budget process, but I think members will have heard the First Minister in answer to a question last week by Faisal Chowdhury about support for culture. So I know the First Minister is very seized of the opportunity, but also the responsibility to fund the culture sector. And if we can get all of these planets in alignment, and I believe we can, we are going to see a transformation of funding, not just the headline number for culture, but how we are doing it. And I think that will be profoundly positive for the arts and culture sector. But I appreciate that when there has been so much concern about funding and there has been so much existential challenge to a lot of venues and organisations, people will believe it when they see it. And they're right to have that feeling, but I think they can have some confidence given we have already begun the uplift in culture funding this year.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. And we know that the regularly funded organisations have a special place in culture funding in Scotland. One of the other concerns that has been raised quite frequently is from organisations that haven't met that criteria. So with the review of Creative Scotland coming up, are the criteria for awarding of grants being looked at, and will that be transparent to those who have the ambition to achieve that multi-year funding?
Yeah. So the first thing is that the process of change from the current funding model to regularly funded organisations to the new funding model on a multi-annual year basis it involves a lot more cultural organisations than is currently funded at the present time. I think from memory, it's something around 115 or so currently regularly funded organisations. And as Creative Scotland has already confirmed to the committee, they are dealing with applications for funding from more than 250 cultural organisations. Now, if we're able to provide the funding and they're able to disperse that, having gone through a process to make sure that there is due diligence involved in all of this, then a lot more organisations will receive funding. Will everybody who wants to be funded be successful? I can't speak for Creative Scotland or the process, but I imagine, as with most funding rounds, not everybody gets everything that they want. But that's not the end of the story. And to your point, Convener, this is about different funding streams. And as the committee will be aware, there is the likes of the Open Fund, which a lot of individuals or smaller projects seek funding support. And that is one of the funding streams that will continue. But there are other ways in which funds are dispersed through Creative Scotland. And this is something that will no doubt be looked at as part of a review. And I think committee members will understand that if you've gone through such a significant change programme, it will lead to a recalibration of funding as dispersed through Creative Scotland. Instead of this happening on an annual basis, a significant part of this will be decided and will then run for a number of years. And so all of this needs to be looked at and considered. Is this going forward the best way in which it should work, as in work as it has up until now, irrespective of the fact that it's having a major change, which is a multi-annual year programme? And then there's an additional dimension to all of this, which I'm not sure I have the answers to all of this, but I'm certain that members of the committee might share this observation. The cultural sector in Scotland, as government sees it, involves our national galleries and museums, and library, our national performing companies. It involves that which is funded through Creative Scotland, and it then has a number of other areas of cultural and artistic life that aren't part of that approach to things. I've always had a question in my mind as to whether there are any gaps in this approach. One of those areas, which is apparent to me where there clearly is, relates to festivals. Festivals, as we all know, are profoundly important. Whether they're a small festival in rural Scotland or whether it's amongst the biggest festivals that we have in Edinburgh, Glasgow and elsewhere. And making sure that we have the right infrastructure in place to make sure that it's properly funded, supported, that government and its agencies are as supportive as they possibly can be. And that is why having a review of what Creative Scotland does and how it does it, whilst at the same time thinking about the different ways in which government supports culture and the arts, makes sure that we are taking a view right across culture and the arts to make sure we're supporting it as well as we can, but also making sure that we have the right institutions in place to make sure that it is properly supported. And we shouldn't lose sight, forgive me, just the last point, that it's not just about organisations and venues. It's also about workers who work in the cultural and arts sector, many of whom are freelance, many of whom have been living a very precarious existence. And I think we need to, and I've said this to the Scottish Trade Union Congress and other unions involved, and I've said it to the Fair Work Task Force, we have to make sure that we are supportive as we possibly can for everybody working in the sector. But as a last thought, I think in relation to the multi-annual year funding process, if our organisations and venues are more sustainably funded, they will be in a much better place to make sure that they are employing, many of them freelancers, as part of the projects, as part of their work programme going forward. So I'm trying to take an approach which makes sure we're looking at the culture and arts sector as a whole and everybody who works in it, whether it's venues, organisations and the workers in it.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I'm going to move to questions to committee and bring Mr Stewart in first, please.
Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Good to see you. Given the concerns that we've already heard from the sector expressed over the last few weeks when we've been taking evidence through this pre-budget process, and the opening statements and comments you've just made, it's all about the need to ensure that the sector remains constant and it also has the confidence for the long-term clarity within that sector. Financial stability has been an area that has been covered by every organisation we've heard from. And today you've given some clarity as to how you see the potential, but there's an if in that potential going forward. And that's before organisations have to deal with the staffing costs, their cultural costs, and even working towards net zero, which are all in their equations as to how they fund themselves for the future. So it's very difficult for these organisations to predict where they will be, and they need the confidence from the government and Creative Scotland and others to give them that opportunity, because everyone tells us they're doing more with less. Mm. But the cultural package that we provide is still very strong and still very buoyant within the communities that we represent. And nationally, we have an organisation and a structure that's there. But it's extremely fragile, Cabinet Secretary, as to where we go for the future. So my first question would be about how do you square that circle to ensure that these individuals and organisations can thrive and survive, as we all want to see them, and they're doing all they can within their own organisations and their own boards and their management structure to do that. But it's extremely difficult for them to see what the future holds without having that stability. And as I say, you said if in your opening statement. Mm.
So something I perhaps wouldn't expect to say about Mr Stewart often in debate. I agree absolutely everything you say, what you said there, Mr Stewart. Your characterisation of where the sector is and where it feels it is, the nature of the challenge, yep, and also the prize, if I can call it that, of getting this right. And would I wish it to be happening quicker? Yes. Absolutely. Because, and I've seen much of the evidence that's been given to the committee, the perfect storm that has existed for the culture and arts sector here, but incidentally elsewhere in the UK and in other countries too, has been profound. The impact, amongst other things, of inflation has been asymmetrical. Yep. So there has been much higher inflation in the arts and culture budget. We can read about that in the newspapers this morning about cultural venues that are trying to restore theatres and the like, and the costs have been going up and so on. So the nature of the challenge has been profound for the sector. And is at the heart of your question. Well, I really hope that we have the answer to this. And the good news is that this significant change for a significant part of the sector, venues and organisations, revolves around multi-annual year funding. This is to be introduced and begin next year. So as we emerge from this time of extreme distress in the sector, we have a commitment by the government, which I have reiterated and I have repeated, and I am 100% committed towards trying to deliver. If we deliver those funding at the scale that we are, at the speed that I would wish it to be, and if we deliver multi-annual year funding, I think will be a significant way forward. And venues and organisations, when they know that they have the funding for a number of years ahead, will be able to get on with what they want to get on with, which is being creative. That is what they want to do, rather than worrying about the bottom line, which of course we need to take account of, but that's why that we have a process about things. And predictability, this is exactly the point, about knowing where you will be, not just this year, not just the end of the financial year, but a number of years ahead. And I think The good news around the applications for funding to Creative Scotland is that the creative sector have been putting in bids as part of the process, which are not just about keeping heads above water. It is about securing their position. Sorry, use your own words, Mr. Stewart. It is about remaining constant. It is about having the long-term clarity, and it's about delivering what they want in creative terms. And I believe that they can. Now, one thing that I want to signal here, because we haven't touched on it yet, is that we've been talking entirely about revenue. Mm-hmm. And I am clear that if we manage to deliver on the commitments of the government, on the trajectory, now there's quite a lot of ifs as part of that, and we're all involved in this in a parliament of minorities, is that I will make the case as part of the budget process to having the funding committed by the government, but we will need to have the budget passed. Because without a budget being passed, the resource will not be there to deliver. And I'm not wanting to create further concerns, because everything, every year, is subject to the parliamentary process and subject to the budgetary process. Everybody understands that. But this is pretty important. So we will need to get the budget through with an added allocation. But there is a kind of asterisk there, which is that there is also a funding around capital. Yeah. I'm very keen to not lose sight of, because there are projects that I would wish to be supportive of that we currently do not have the capital funding allocation at the present time.
You've talked also about the review of Creative Scotland in this whole process, and I think that's very important that we have clarity as to where that organisation is going and what's going to happen. You've also touched this morning about the number of applications that go into that organisation, and they're not able to provide and support. So that organisation, in its own way, isn't fulfilling its own obligations to the sector, because it can't. It has to then decide as to how it rations the money and rations the resource. So is it time to see a change within the creative sector, and the review may have an implication for Creative Scotland? Is there anything within that you want to express or explain to us?
Because, okay.
You know, well, some people have said that this could be the demise of Creative Scotland.
Well, that's not the... Well, so firstly, I tried to draw a picture of a changed, improved landscape for the culture and arts sector in Scotland, which by its very nature will have, must have, and it has to be at arm's length, a funding body which is able to deliver. And I would like to pay tribute, I have before this committee before, I will do it again, to what Creative Scotland did during COVID, which was with the money that we have a responsibility for making sure the taxpayers' resources are managed well, they dispersed millions of pounds of absolutely essential support to keep the creative sector from going under. And they did it well. And I think they deserve our respect for that. But it's also true to say that it's an organisation that hasn't been reviewed since its establishment, which is going through this massive change programme. And once we have delivered on that, once they have concluded the process, with the government having allocated the funds, and hopefully with colleagues approving it in Parliament, I think there is a question about how it works, how the rest of the cultural landscape fits in. My point about is everything being thought about in a holistic way? But it would be wrong for me to prejudge. I'm sure you're not wishing me to prejudge any review, because this needs to be looked at by, you know, there's not going to be a government review, in the sense that I'm not going to sit at the head of this and drive a review. Others are going to look very closely at how things operate. And we need to have a look at international best practice. But again, I would seek to underline the point. Creative Scotland is introducing a process as the first in the United Kingdom to do so.
Absolutely.
And I think that's a really, really good thing. And I know it's a good thing, because people elsewhere in the UK are very interested in it. When I met Lisa Nandy, for example, my Culture Secretary, opposite number in the UK government. She was very interested to learn about where this process is, because we are doing it first, yeah. and Creative Scotland's doing it first. So I'm very keen to support them conclude the process, and then for us to think about how everything is fitting together and how everything is working. But I don't want to prejudge that.
I appreciate, and you know, we all want to see the sector thrive and survive. And as I say, it has been extremely resilient, been supported by organisations like the Scottish Government and others to keep it in that place. But Cabinet Secretary, if we don't get this right,
yeah.
then it will mean the decline of the sector over the months and years ahead. Unless that resources and the equation and the challenges actually change. And if we don't change, that will not happen.
I couldn't agree more. Absolutely right. We have been advised about what the scale of financial support is that is being required for change. I think it was Culture Counts. Yeah. That estimated that would be around £100 million additional on an annual basis. That is the point that I made in government. That is what has been agreed in government and has been avowed, and repeatedly so, by the last First Minister and by John Swinney and by myself, again before the committee. This is what we are aiming to deliver. The fact that colleagues from other political parties are reiterating the scale of the challenge, the necessity of applying the additional finance, the change to the way in which finance is delivered, and doing so sustainably, fills me with hope that if we are all in agreement about what is required, I'm going to do what I need to do in government to try and make sure that we are able to deliver the increasing funding on a year-on-year basis, and then it will be up to all of us as MSPs within our own parties to be persuasive about why it will be important to pass a budget that does just that. And I would appeal to Mr. Stewart and all colleagues, especially those in other political parties, to be as supportive as they can be.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Mr. Harvey. Excuse me.
Thanks very much, Convener. I think, Cabinet Secretary, there's a great deal in the picture that you're painting that the committee would welcome and that the sector would welcome. Increased resource, long-term certainty, yep. a review of the remit and operations of Creative Scotland. I think there is a welcome for that. But I hope I'm right in hearing from you that you understand it will take time for the sector to actually rebuild trust, given the turbulence and the stop-start nature of funding, particularly very recently. And it will take time and the delivery of those commitments for that trust and confidence to build if the government does commit to that. There has been some discussion in our evidence about the short term, the immediate, the coming financial year, step toward that £100 million commitment. One witness said to us, if the figure for the coming financial year is 20 million, it will not touch the sides. So I appreciate you're not going to be in a position to give us a figure right now, but do you hear and recognise the evidence that's been given to us on the committee that clearly indicates it's going to have to be significantly more than that in order to just be taken seriously?
I couldn't agree more. And as I observed in a previous answer, the scale of the funding step change that is necessary for the culture sector to thrive has been worked through and has been estimated as an additional £100 million. Mm-hmm. And the government agrees. And that's why we're working towards
28. I'm
and
about the
indeed, year. And so the point that Mr. Harvey makes, and welcome to the committee, incidentally, about how can one do that as quickly as possible is the key challenge. The quicker that I can persuade colleagues, when I think we all appreciate there are significant challenges right across public administration, and there is a demand right across the public services to be funded as well as can
Absolutely.
Be. Government has a difficult job of trying to balance all of this. I will be making the case that we deliver on the commitments that we have made. The then Deputy First Minister, who's remained the Finance Secretary, Shona Robertson, said, and I printed this out because I wanted to be reminded of this, during her budget speech on December the 19th, 2023, confirmed the increase of £15.8 million for this financial year, of which already I have confirmed a number of times now, more than £15 million of which has already been dispersed. And then went on to say that our aim is to increase arts and culture investment in 25-26 by at least a further £25 million. So that's the next step change. And clearly, a significant part of that will need to go towards the multi-annual year funding requirements of Creative Scotland. But by its very nature, because it is multi-annual year funding, if we can continue to increase on a year-on-year basis, and that is the intention of the government, that is how we'll be able to fund that change. Now, Mr. Harvey might wish to intervene and say, well, the point was there is more than multi-annual year funding and more than the organisations that will be funded by that route. There will be from our national performing companies. There will be from national museums and galleries. There will be from festivals. There will be from the Youth Music Initiative, from Sistema, and. There will continue to be a hope and an expectation of moving from sustain to thrive. Yep. So where are the additional resources? And that is what I am, together with my officials and advice from others, trying to make sure we're getting that balance right as we increase the funding going forward. Will we get that balance right? I hope so, because it's really important that we do so. And this is where I would welcome, and I've said this before, convener, the work that you do really helps inform the consideration that we give in government about those relative priorities. But if I can highlight one challenge in particular, because mention has been made of, you know, how can we work with a funding body on these things going forward. I think one of the challenges we've objectively had in the last year is that we have been working to different budgetary timetables. So if we look at the challenge that we had around the Open Fund, that was Creative Scotland operating to a Creative Scotland budgetary timeline, and the same goes with multi-annual year funding, and we have a governmental and a parliamentary timescale in which we consider budgets, and they are not in sync. So if we're asking our publicly funded bodies to do a job on our behalf, and we also have to, with due diligence, make sure that taxpayers' money is being dispersed responsibly, we have to make sure that we're in sync as much as we can. And I would hope that that's one of those areas where a review can advise us about how we can best do that. Because if I was a creative out there trying to get on with being creative and keeping one's head above water in difficult times, my view on that would be, please, can you just get these kind of administrative questions sorted?
Thank you.
And I understand that.
Yeah.
And that is one of the areas where I think we can do better. I hope we can do better. And I think a review might help give us some of the answers about how
Thank you.
Do that.
If there's time for a follow-up, quite an extensive answer. Thank you for that. And on that last point, I think there's also a need for the alignment with the timescales that are relevant to individuals and organisations, including small organisations, including freelancers, if the disbursement of funding still leaves them facing a crunch moment in relation to how their finances work, then they can end up not getting the benefit from it. But I wanted to go on and talk about the relationship with the review, because there is a huge opportunity from the review, but there is a bit of a danger of a kind of chicken and egg or cart before horse. I'm not sure which metaphor is right here, but the relationship between funding and the review of its remit, Creative Scotland's remit and operations. Let me give you one example of the kind of potential negative consequence that some people may be worried about. Creative Scotland's had some criticism in some of what it's done. I think one area that, as far as I can tell, is pretty well regarded is Screen Scotland, doing pretty well. My personal view is that the games sector would benefit from a similar high-profile approach, a similarly high-profile unit within Creative Scotland looking at the games sector, which has sometimes fallen between the kind of creative and the enterprise parts of government. Now, I know the government's serious about its potential and has talked about developing a games strategy, but if the review of Creative Scotland said, amongst other things, one thing it should do is have a more high-profile and well-resourced games unit, is there a risk that the rest of the culture sector says, hang on, we thought that extra 100 million was all for us? You know, is there a danger that in looking at the remit, we end up not seeing all of that additional committed money going to what we currently cover yep. in the creative sector, but actually the movement of pots of money within government? So there's two questions in one there. One's about the games sector and the potential yeah. for Creative Scotland to do some really good stuff there, yeah. which I would like to see happen. But the other is, what's the impact on the existing funding streams and the people who benefit from it if Creative Scotland was to take on something new within yeah. 100 million?
So, I again, total agreement has broken out at this hearing. I totally agree with the observations that Mr. Harvey has made. Firstly, on the review, that it's an opportunity, and that's how I view it. I genuinely view it as an opportunity to help us better understand what Creative Scotland does well, about what we need to do differently, and making sure that we're not missing out on the different parts of the creative sector. And Mr. Harvey alights on an important question. We currently have a screen sector that is responsible in the support and development of that which is produced for television, that which is produced for the big screen mm-hmm. At the cinema, but not for a screen, small or large, in the game sector. Yeah. And you might say, wouldn't be right for me to put words in your mouth, but you or any other member of the committee might say to me, is what the game sector does very effectively, incidentally, mm-hmm. not also part of a continuum of what happens for television and for the film sector? Are the skills not transferable? Are aspects of the game sector not the same as they are for film and television? Take soundtrack, for example, the music for the game sector. Is there a difference between that might be produced for a television programme or a film to the game, to which the answer is no. So is this an area where a review might look? Absolutely. Because in case anybody watching proceedings doesn't know, film and television is within Screen Scotland, which is part of Creative Scotland, yep. and the support for the game sector is not.
Yeah.
It is part of the Scottish Enterprise Network. Yeah. Now, that is a historic decision. I wasn't around at the time. I'm sure there was a good logic for it.
Not really.
Now, is that something that we should look at? I'm not drawing limits on how a review can consider the creative landscape. And the second point, and it can't be a subsidiary point because it is that important, is that the funding of that has to follow the responsibility. Mm-hmm. So if there's any decisions that something needs to come to culture or leaves, then the funding follows. And Mr. Harvey might point out that this is exactly what's happened recently around events, which was part of my portfolio responsibility, had to deliver the likes of the Cycling World Championships, mm-hmm. and is now... Yep. back part of the economic portfolio, and the money assigned to it has gone with the responsibility. But I don't want to get too far ahead of myself, but I think Mr. Harvey has, I mean, I think he was modest in his description of screen being doing pretty well. It's doing unbelievably well. This is an industry that is now worth £635 million, give or take some millions, gross value added a year. And by 2030, by independent estimation, it's going to be a more than £1 billion industry to Scotland. And that's not including the games sector. Mm-hmm. So it's one of the great stories that we have in our creative and cultural firmament. And should government and our agencies do everything that we can to help them survive and thrive? Absolutely. And should a review look at that? Yes, it should.
Okay. Thank you, Convener.
Mr. Bibby.
Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. You've been agreeing a lot with the premise of the questions from members of the committee this morning. I wondered if you would agree that the culture sector in Scotland is in crisis. Mm-hmm.
I would agree that the culture sector is emerging from crisis. I think it has, by any objective criteria, looking at the challenges for a number of organisations and venues, obviously not every organisation has been going through a crisis, but the pressures have been such that I think there has been a collective crisis and we are in the process of emerging from it. I spend a lot of my time, as do my officials, making sure that we are supporting organisations and venues who have been confronting very existential challenges, because we want our organisations, we want our venues to survive. And as we are able to find and allocate and disperse the increased funding, we will move from that sustaining phase, which some people have described as being crisis, and I acknowledge, I think for many it has been a crisis, that we are emerging from that. I think that's where we are now.
Thanks for that answer. And certainly we've heard, you know, significant evidence from mm-hmm. the sector that they are still facing a huge crisis. Museums Gallery Scotland has told the committee we've reached a point at which so many organisations are in crisis, they are struggling to do the really good work that we know can be done. Culture Counts have warned this committee that the crisis facing Scotland's cultural sector is an immediate one, and Creative Scotland have said they're working with a number of organisations in crisis and on cliff edges. We've also had, I know, a recent letter to the First Minister from prominent figures in Scotland's music scene, including Paolo Rotini, Biffy Clyro and 170 others, have raised concerns about an impending cultural catastrophe unless the Scottish Government provides immediate and reliable support to the sector. Given that we are facing a crisis in the culture sector, given that we are facing an impending cultural catastrophe, why do you think we are in this situation, and what is the Scottish Government going to do to act to stop this cultural catastrophe and help avoid this crisis?
So I know Mr. Bibby has already been listening very closely to the last 40-plus minutes of evidence in which I've been outlining the commitment to extremely significantly increase funding for the cultural sector, to go through a change to the way in which funding is allocated in line with the wishes of the sector, that it be on a multi-annual year basis. The embracing of the opportunity to look across the creative and cultural landscape to make sure that we have its administration in the best possible order and that we deliver on that change as quickly as possible. And here's a challenge for us all. We can't just wish the means. We have to vote for it. And we will have a budget soon in which I hope I will be able to secure the agreement of my colleagues in government that we will provide an allocation for culture which is heading in the direction that they would wish. We would all wish it to be delivered in 1 year, no doubt. I will try and be as persuasive as I can be, but I think realistically, because of the scale of increase that is required and we have committed to, that it will take a number of years to do so, but we'll have to vote for it. And if we don't pass a budget, sitting and pointing out that things have been extremely challenging, that for many it has been a crisis, but then not to support the means and not to vote for it, that will be a real problem.
We've talked this morning a lot about the need for confidence and certainty in the sector, but I think actually what we're seeing is chaos and a mess. Because I have been listening closely to what you've been saying, Cabinet Secretary. You said you want to reassure the sector, you want to provide a stable environment. But then we're also saying, if we can secure the increase in funding, and also I will try to persuade colleagues. The Scottish Government have promised, give clear commitments and promises to increase the mm-hmm. budget by at least £25 million in 25-26 for months. Cabinet Secretary, you said that. First Minister said it, Deputy First Minister. And yet half an hour before this committee meets this morning, you write to Creative Scotland saying we can't tell you what the funding position is going to be next year.
Oh.
This is chaotic.
So, let me be absolutely clear about the budgetary process for anybody watching who is not aware that Scotland's budget is dependent on budgetary decisions made by the UK government. Without having clarity from the UK government about our budgetary system, because we don't have multi-annual funding for the Scottish Parliament government, Mr. Bibby knows this to be so.
Yep.
In circumstances of previous incoming governments, the length of time in which a UK budget took place and there was clarity is as follows. In 1979, a change of government led to a budget in 1 month and 9 days. In 1997, Gordon Brown delivered an incoming budget after 2 months and 1 day. In 2010, George Osborne delivered a UK budget in 1 month and 16 days. Rachel Reeve, as the incoming UK Chancellor of the Exchequer, is going to deliver her budget 3 months and 26 days after the election. Yeah. And my point is this, and it's really important.
Yeah.
I would wish to have been able to give clarity to the creative sector a lot earlier than we have been able to do. But we are entirely dependent on clarity from the UK government about what our budgetary situation is likely to be. I don't think any responsible member of the Scottish Parliament would be suggesting that we could unilaterally make budgetary decisions without any idea of what our budgetary situation is going to be. Would I wish us to have had earlier clarity? Absolutely. Could the UK government have given us that? No, they have not. So we will, as quickly as we possibly can, have a budget following the UK's budget. And I am, in the meantime, making every case that I can in government to make sure that the funding is in place. But, Mr. Bibby, you cannot, on the one hand, say that we should give promises about funding when we have absolutely zero clarity from the UK Labour government more than 3 months after the general election.
And you gave those commitments for an extra £25 million. Mm-hmm. How many months ago?
We gave it last year in the budget speech.
So almost 12 months ago.
Yes, that's for this. This is for this incoming year.
So did you have clarity then?
I had.
When you made that commitment, when you made that promise, you had clarity then, but you don't know.
So last year we made not only a commitment to increase £100 million, to confirming that we would be increasing it by £15 million. And that there was an intention, I've already read it to the committee, I don't think I need to do it for a second time, that the aim was to do it by the scale of £25 million this year. This is the scale of the agreement that I'm trying to secure from ministerial colleagues. But we have to do it on the basis of knowing what the actual budgetary situation is like. Otherwise, I'd be coming before this committee and I would be traduced by colleagues for literally making up numbers which are undeliverable. We have made a commitment to increase cultural funding by £100 million. We committed to doing it so by more than £15 million this year, and we have done so. And we have confirmed the aim for this forthcoming year for it to be in the order of £25 million. That is exactly what I'm intent on persuading my colleagues to deliver, and subverting the budget process by not doing it on the basis of what we actually know the financial situation to be is just not a credible description of the budgetary process that we have to operate within in a parliamentary democracy.
Well, forgive me, Commissioner, I thought you'd already persuaded your government colleagues of an additional £25 million.
I have.
Over the coming... So what are you trying to... So
you've I have persuaded... Them, so. I have persuaded my colleagues of the order of the increase in funding which is required. I've persuaded colleagues about the allocation for this current financial year, and I made the case last year, which was confirmed in the speech by my finance secretary colleague. I'll read it out again for colleagues who might not have heard it. Our aim is to increase arts and cultural investment for 25-26 by at least a further £25 million. Now, my job is to make sure that what we do is more than aim for. And I think everybody, every fair-minded person knows that when you have made a commitment to significant increase, when you have said that you hope to be able to do it as quickly as possible, to say that you aim to do it is a noble and worthy thing, but there's a difference between that and actually making a financial allocation in a budgetary process. Mm-hmm. That is what I want to make sure that we have as part of the budget going forward for the next year, and in due time we'll be arguing for the further steps in the increase to £100 million. But there is no way around a normal budgetary process, Mr. Bibby. As we know, Scottish government budgets are presented to the Scottish Parliament after UK government budgets because our financial situation is subordinate in devolution. It's one of the great shortcomings of being beholden to another place to make decisions, we hope, good decisions. Now, I hope the UK government budget provides the means for us to be able to deliver. I really do. And I would call on the UK government not to continue with the austerity agenda which it inherited, but unfortunately looks set to continue doing. I would, for the point of clarity, point out that in contrast to the rest of the United Kingdom, we are actually increasing culture spending in Scotland. Spending is going up. Under this government in Scotland, it is going down right now under the new and current UK government. And it is going down right now in Wales under a Labour government there. Here in Scotland, culture funding is going up. Would I wish it to go up more quickly? Absolutely. Am I trying to do everything that I possibly can to make sure that we reach the commitment of an additional £100 million by 28-29? Absolutely. But we've started. It's happening. It's going up. Multi-annual year funding is coming. The resources need to be found. They do. And they need to be voted through in Parliament. And that will require all of us, and all of us thus far, I'm assuming, are suggesting they are supportive of having the additional means. If we wish to have the additional means, we're going to have to vote for it.
Well, obviously, the government's made promises, and you said earlier the sector will believe it when they see it, and yeah, I'll believe it when I see it.
So, and sorry, just as a point of, as an additional point, I think it's helpful for viewers to be aware that the current Scottish government is operating in a minority parliamentary situation. So to get a budget through, it will require a majority of MSPs to vote for the budget. And that's why it's not just a question of commitments by the government. I've given the government's commitments. I've underscored the government's commitments. I reiterate the government's commitments. What I would wish to communicate with colleagues is, if we are agreed that the scale of the challenge is such as it is, and if we are agreed that we require to deliver additional resources of the scale that the government has committed to wanting to deliver, then we need to vote for it.
I'm sorry, Cabinet Secretary, I don't think you have underscored the government's commitments today. I think in your letter to Creative Scotland half an hour before this committee, you have provided huge uncertainty about the budget position this year, having given clear commitments to provide £25 million extra additional next year, and that's not what the government are doing today. So you've not underscored the commitments this morning. You've actually provided huge uncertainty to the sector because they have no idea what funding they're going to get next year.
Well, I totally refute.
Can I just say, I think we're not going to reach an agreement here, obviously, and you know, it's not helpful if we do get opinions thrown into the answers at this point. So if we could move on, and I'm going to bring in Mr. Adam.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Unlike Mr. Bibby, when I see challenges, I see try to think of ways to actually solve the problems. That's maybe telling in itself, actually, as we move forward. But one of the things that, and thanks for explaining to those that were having difficulty with how the budgetary process works, Cabinet Secretary, but one of the things that is quite kind of telling, and you brought up, Mr. Bibby may have accidentally stumbled into a solution to the problem, in so much as, you know, there's talk of uncertainty in budgetary. It's because of the way the devolution settlement, how the budget works. It's always been the case. I've been here long enough and been in enough committees across the board in different kind of portfolios to know that this is an argument that's made by other portfolios as well. If the UK government, Mr. Bibby's stumbled into the idea that maybe if we did have multi-year budgets from the UK government, yes, possibly that might be a solution and might help towards the idea of moving away to this uncertainty and difficulties and challenges that many sectors in the that government supports.
So the position of the Scottish Government is we would wish to have multi-annual year budgetary settlements in the UK. Because at the present time, we're trying to make a dispersal of government funds on a multi-annual basis on the basis of unclarity from a UK Labour government, which is taking three times longer than its predecessors to give any clarity about the budget whatsoever. So having multi-annual clarity would be a good thing, and that would allow us to allocate the funds. But I don't think we should be blown off course from understanding how things actually are. I am an optimist about the trajectory of recovery for the culture sector. Why am I? Because we have acknowledged the scale of the challenge. I think there's agreement that that is... the scale of the challenge financially is that which the government has committed to, and I have committed to a number of times in evidence before you before now and today again. That is the aim of what we want to commit to as soon as we can. And if we do that, I am very confident that the funding of culture will be in a better place. If UK governments want to make the devolution settlement work better, then things are required to happen on a multi-annual year basis, or de minimis, holding a budget quicker than this incoming UK Labour government would be of huge assistance, because taking three times as long as all predecessors is not something that contributes to improving the budgetary process.
Another thing I would say is traditionally, in the past, you know, you're almost talking the culture sector, not you, but people saying otherwise, you're talking the culture sector down, because they've dealt with challenging political times and financial times in the past, and they've always been a very resilient sector who have been able, in fact, in many cases, you and I remember the dim, dark 80s when culturally Scotland, the culture sector was Scotland, you know, and it was our political voice because this place didn't exist. So surely, you know, the culture sector isn't in that place where it's always been a resilient sector that's been able to come forward with new ways of working, new ideas and kind of pushing forward Scotland in the world.
I totally agree. And it has to be on the basis of our understanding as a government and as a parliament and the political parties in that parliament that if the scale of the challenge is as it has been, and we are agreed that we want to make sure that we provide the means to be able for them to succeed right across the creative sector, then we have to deliver on the means for them to be able to do so. And I am confident that we are emerging from the crisis that large parts of the culture sector have been operating under in Scotland and the rest of the United Kingdom. But unlike the rest of the United Kingdom, where culture budgets are being cut by the Labour government for England and being cut by the Labour government in Wales for culture, in Scotland, funding is going up. Now, I know some observers find it very difficult to acknowledge that funding is actually going up in Scotland. It is. I'm glad that it is. And I want it to go up by more. And that's exactly what we are aiming to do.
Just one final question, convener, if that's okay. With regards to the review of Creative Scotland, we had various creative organisations come in, giving evidence during this budgetary process. And you've mentioned as well that Creative Scotland, since its inception, hasn't changed. Now, okay, I may have a wee bit of skin in this game, because I did actually ask Ian Munro what is the point of him and Creative Scotland, because I may have been a wee bit brutal with him. But basically, I wasn't getting the answers. Then I got a history lesson on why Creative or National Arts Council Creative Scotland was created post-war. But for me, surely, if you look in the back of what Mr Harvey said about the games industry, Screen Scotland, being an offshoot of Creative Scotland, has been an absolute screaming success. You know, when you look at these other ways, surely, if you're looking at changes or reviewing Creative Scotland, surely there's different ways of working, and Creative Scotland needs to maybe start thinking about coming into the 21st century and moving forward.
Well, I think the purposes of a review is for all of us to consider how the creative and cultural landscape operates in Scotland, the role of an independent arm's length funding body plays. I don't think there are any serious players in the cultural community who question the need for a funding body, that that funding body should be an arm's length funding body, and that it should be operating, it should be chiming with the needs, the interests, the concerns, the expectations of the sector in 2024. And I know that they have done much really good work. I acknowledged especially the dispersal of funds around around COVID. But I think it's fair to say that if we are making major changes, and we are with the introduction of multi-annual year funding and the significant increase in culture funding, sorry, I should say, not only is the funding going up in Scotland this year, but I think I'm right in saying we are the only government in the UK that is committed to increasing culture by the scale that we are. There's been no confirmation to the UK government about any increasing in culture funding for the years ahead. We have to think about how do we manage that increased funding. How do we do it in a way that we're making sure that whether it's our national institutions, whether it's our national performing companies, whether it's our festivals, whether it's other cultural bodies, that we have the appropriate administration and support of that for the 2020s, and Creative Scotland was set up in 2010. I'm not going to prejudge what the outcome of such a review would be, and I don't want to set limits on any recommendations that might be, and no doubt the committee will hear many suggestions of what that might be, and I'm sure that will play a part of the process as well. But I think we all need to acknowledge that we have now, and we had previously, in different guises of course, a national arts funding body that was arm's length. We've had questions from committee members about the scope of its responsibility. Are there other things that should be considered in scope of Creative Scotland? And so on. And these are the things that we need to get right at the same time as getting the funding in place. And we are beginning to head in that direction. And so I think the time is right that we think about these things in parallel.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Ms. Gallagher.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. We've spoken a lot this morning about Creative Scotland and the review, and I think the review is timely given the controversies that's happened this year, and hopefully it would allow better working relationships, I think, between the publicly funded body and perhaps the Scottish Government. However, I think it is right to say that the decisions that Creative Scotland can take in relation to the budget that's made available to them does depend on how much the Scottish Government can provide to them. And we've had the Creative Scotland Chief Executive Ian Munro state that it's due to a lack of clarity over the budget that was part of the reason why they decided to close their open fund. Now, I've got an FOI in front of me that's dated the 27th of August that requested any correspondence between yourself as the Cabinet Secretary and Creative Scotland regarding the announcement of the closure of the open fund. But the response that I received states that there hadn't been any discussions between yourself as Cabinet Secretary and Creative Scotland regarding this significant announcement. Now, as it's £6.6 million that we're talking about here, surely there would have been correspondence between the Scottish Government and Creative Scotland. So can I ask why those discussions didn't take place? Or if they did take place, can you please clarify, you know, sure, what discussions did take place?
Well, the first thing I would say is, I'm sure Ms. Gallagher is aware, not everything that the government does is done by the Cabinet Secretary, and not everything that the government does is done in correspondence. And a lot of the work that happens between officials. I think the main challenge in relation to the Open Fund was around the issue of timescales. And of due diligence in relation to the dispersal of public funds. Now, as I've said already to the committee, I think one of those areas that a review around Creative Scotland will be very useful for everybody is trying to make sure that we have maximum alignment with the budgetary processes of the government and the parliament, with the budgetary processes of Creative Scotland, and the budgetary processes of the cultural sector. Because if any of that is out of alignment, then we run the risk of people who have responsibility in one area unable to do what they want to do because they're waiting on others to do due diligence
or for the government to agree, or for the parliament to agree, or for the funds to be dispersed. And I think having the least discontinuity on those three levels, I think, is absolutely key. Creative Scotland knew the scale of the funding that we intended, because funding doesn't just go out at the start of the year, it goes out at different stages of the year. I'm sure committee members know that. Creative Scotland knew about the scale of the funding that we had committed to disperse, because we had made a commitment and we had made an allocation in last year's budget of £15.8 million. And that's exactly what we did. And so they have the funding in place. The open fund is open. I would observe that they have had significantly more applications for funding through the open fund, which speaks to the characterisation of a number of members of the committee who have said the scale of the demand for financial support is significant in the sector. I acknowledge that. Mm-hmm. And no doubt in future years, the size of the fund no doubt will be looked at. But this is the other area for a review to look at. Once multi-annual year funding has come in, does that have an impact on the different funding streams, whether that's the Open Fund or others for Creative Scotland? But to go back to the initial question that Ms. Gallagher asked about the way in which government operates, I don't do everything personally. It's officials that work on a day-to-day basis between the Culture Directorate and the and Creative Scotland, and there are constant ongoing discussions about funding issues. What I know, and I met Creative Scotland last week to talk about their plans for multi-annual year funding, our challenges around the budgetary timescale, and we are both agreed that we want to make sure that multi-annual year funding is able to progress, that we as a government are able to secure the funding and give them the certainty that they have to be able to launch multi-annual year funding, and that we make sure as part of a review that we have the best possible alignment around our different budgetary processes. I'm sure everyone in the committee gets some organisations do budgets Monday to Sunday, do from January to December, and others have a financial year which runs at a different period through the year. So there are a number of areas around budget, quite apart from the quantum of the funding that we're wanting to have allocated, but it's about the different budgetary challenges that we have as organisations, whether as a funding body or as government and a parliament. And I don't think anybody's seriously suggesting that there is a shortcut around the budgetary process for the government and the parliament. I don't think I've heard anybody say that we should do that. At the same time, we have to be cognizant that other organisations do operate at different timescales. So how do we make sure that we do that in a way that there is not detriment to people, in this case, in the creative and cultural communities? And I'm very seized of that.
No, I understand where the Cabinet Secretary is coming from in respect of multi-year funding. And of course, it's not just Creative Scotland, of course, who are looking to see a new way of funding being allocated from the Scottish Government to those organisations, Historic Environment Scotland being another one, of course, who would like to see a progression to multi-year funding. And I'm wondering what conversations the Scottish Government has had with Historic Environment Scotland, because I'm very concerned actually about where their budgetary situation is in terms of prioritisation of historic sites, and whether or not actually there will be significant reductions in what they're able to carry out and the important work that they do.
Yep. On historic environment, well, firstly, on the general point about multi-annual year funding, I think there's a huge interest around the third sector as a whole in multi-annual year funding working. And that's why I think what's happening in culture, quite apart from the self-evident advantages it would bring in the cultural sector, proving that it is workable to move from an annual funding model to a multi-annual year funding model, I think is a huge prize for the third sector as a whole. And so what's true in the culture sector in terms of the arts is definitely true in the heritage sector as well, and is true in the charitable sector and so on as well. So it's definitely something that government is thinking about. But more than that, and this is where Historic Environment Scotland is in a very interesting place, because they've also wanted to have greater freedom to be able to determine their own budgetary circumstances. And I have agreed with that. And so I think this is something that the Historic Environment Scotland's last meeting of their board was able to agree on their plan in relation to that. And that's hugely interesting, and no doubt the committee may take a view on whether it wants to better understand how that operates. But Historic Environment Scotland, as an organisation, is one that has been very successful, is having to deal with the challenges that I think have been alluded to in relation to what's happened on an environmental basis to a lot of our historic infrastructure and the work that they're doing to maintain and protect that. I think Historic Environment Scotland, from a budgetary point of view, are being given the freedom to be able to have more in the way of income through their own efforts, and I welcome that, and I'm very supportive of that. Shona, is there anything that you wanted to add on that point?
Just to add that the new Chief Executive of Historic Environment Scotland, Katerina Brown, has just started in post, and following her arrival in the institution, their board have just this week signed off a new business model, which we've been discussing closely with them, which, exactly as the Cabinet Secretary says, will allow them to keep more of the revenue that they raise.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Mr. Brown.
Thank you. Two questions, both to do with sustainability. I think many people watching this will think to themselves, is it just sheer hypocrisy to demand certainty and multi-year funding from the Scottish Government and at the same time say nothing about £160 million being taken out of the Scottish Government's budget at 90 minutes' notice? Two things can't coexist, and where they do, it's hypocritical in my view. However, it's also true to say that in relation to financial sustainability, I think, as Megan Gallagher says, all sorts of different groups, and I think the Cabinet Secretary has mentioned this, the third sector generally would be very keen to have multi-year funding. How you can have that when you don't have the certainty from Westminster is a big question. However, can I say that is it not the case that the culture sector is slightly different? First of all, in terms of how precarious the evidence that we've received as a committee, they feel themselves to be. But also, if you have an endpoint, the £100 million plus in 2008, then what you're talking about is, so you know that you're going to be spending £100 million more by 2008. The bridge to that, is that not a more manageable kind of process for seeing how you get to from one to the other than it would be in relation to a number of other sectors? Is that not something that both the almost unique precariousness of this sector and the fact that you have an endpoint in place that you can usefully use with your colleagues to look further at whether indications could be given as to what funding is likely to be over the next 3 or 4 years?
So I think Mr. Brown's absolutely right to point out the challenges, particularly for a lot of freelancers, in relation to their income. And he's absolutely right that it's important that maximum clarity about increasing funding is forthcoming. So to be exact, I was looking through the figures before to answer Mr. Bibby to underline the point about the direction of travel. So in Scotland, we've been absolutely clear that we are committed to increasing funding by an additional £100 million on an annual basis. And the compare and contrast of the outgoing previous UK government, funding levels being maintained by the incoming government, it sees a 6% reduction in the budget relating to culture for England. And in Wales, is down by 6.5% cut this year, while in Scotland it's going up. So I appreciate that people want certainty, but what they should know is that the direction of travel in Scotland is for culture spending to go up. Not just has this been committed to, it is happening. Unlike elsewhere in the UK, where the Labour Party, at a UK level, and the Labour Party in Wales are cutting culture. I'm proud to be Culture Secretary in Scotland, where we're increasing culture funding, and we are heading in the direction of a transformational shift in funding culture and the arts in Scotland. Would I wish it to happen quicker? Absolutely. Am I seeking to do it as quickly as possible? Yes. When we get there, are we going to be in a significantly different and better place? Yes, we are. Could we do it any quicker? Well, if we had multi-annual year funding agreement from the UK government, we would have that. We don't. There is no intention by the current UK Labour government to do that, and I haven't heard a single one of their parliamentarians in this place argue that we should. But it is self-evident that if we want multi-annual year funding disbursement, it would be advantageous to have multi-annual year clarity from the UK government in relation to devolved budgets, given the subordinate financial nature of the devolution settlement. And so any colleagues in any party that recognise that as a common sense solution as we move in the direction of Megan Gallagher's suggestion about the widest possible multi-annual year funding approach of government, which I agree, it would be the best thing for everybody involved. For people watching proceedings here who might view this as being a slightly technical question, an accounting question, well, just has to imagine for a second being a really small organisation, in particular a small organisation, with not a lot of people to do the paperwork and the finance and the budgeting. The transformational difference between having to do that every single year and then only having to do it for a number of years and then getting on with the business at hand, which is being as creatively focused as they wish to be. I think that has to be the prize for us all. But for us to do that, again, we have to wish the means. And to be critical of, you know, when is a commitment not a commitment, when one actually can see the money heading and beginning to head in the right direction, I think we need to be careful here that we are recognising the challenge, but then actually doing something about it. And the government is. And the Parliament will have an opportunity to do that in the budgetary process. And then if we are supportive of the budget, and we will have to be, we will hopefully have the means secured, committed to, of course, but secured as part of the budgetary process. And that's where how finance works in a parliamentary democracy.
Yeah, I mean, just leave the Cabinet Secretary with that suggestion, though, which was to try and strengthen his arm in relation to discussions with colleagues to say that there may be a particular case for the culture sector, given its precariousness, and also the fact that an endpoint, the £100 million plus, has been identified already, just to leave it, not looking for a response on that. And I think it will be interesting to see if, and I believe that he will, the Cabinet Secretary achieves a £25 million plus next year, if people in this Parliament who say they want to see an increase compared to what's happening elsewhere support it or not. And I would predict just now that they won't, is my view. However, the second question I had was on sustainability, but morale rather than finances. We had a lot of evidence, and if you read the accounts of the committee's last meeting, about morale in the sector not being good, partly from reasons we've heard, whether it's the perfect storm that people have experienced, the other pressures that they have, which sits a wee bit at odds with the fact, as the Cabinet Secretary said, that in Scotland we're talking about an increasing budget pretty uniquely. However, they did feel on various levels that they didn't have access or inclusion with the Scottish Government in the way that they'd want to. I think they're reeling somewhat from the effect of the decision not to have a culture minister, which puts additional pressure on yourself, Cabinet Secretary, as well as external affairs and Europe. You have to take that on. But they are looking for greater engagement. In the constrained financial times that there are, I think discussion, dialogue, engagement on a regular basis with the sector would go a long way. If you read some of the testimony of the stakeholders that we heard, if it's possible to do that. I know that's time-consuming, yep. But can you offer any support to the sector in that regard?
I absolutely can. So on the issue of inclusion and engagement, I can give the committee the assurance that that is constant and is ongoing. I made mention in my open statement about meetings held recently with trades unions in the sector. But if we take alone one important part of the cultural firmament, which is our festivals, we heard through the summer leading members of our festivals sector saying that they were very keen for there to be a focused level of support from government on what they do. Now, some people set the bar really low and suggested maybe we should have a meeting. And I said, no, this is much more important than having a meeting. This is about actually having a proper strategic partnership with the sector, which is why I announced a strategic partnership when it comes to festivals. This is not about having more meetings or having more working groups that are not focused and do not have an outcome. But when I'm being asked a question where it's suggested that there isn't enough interaction, I'm giving an example of where we are bringing in a framework, a partnership, as we did for the delivery of large events. It's exactly what we did with the likes of the Cycling World Championships, and it was extremely successful. Having learnt from that, what we have done on events, it's exactly what I'm intending that we do in when it comes to the festival sector. And here's where thinking about culture in the round and making sure that we're not missing any part of the culture sector, this is why the conversations are significant and ongoing. I regularly say yes to having meetings with people from right across the sector, whether it's the Music Venue Trust, who've been raising issues recently. Some committee members will be aware of issues around that and ticketing and how does one support musical venues. And I have people from the likes of the Music Industry Association also in touch, wanting to meet about the music sector and touring and performing. I say yes to these meetings because it's really important that we have that dialogue, that I'm as well as advised as and colleagues in the civil service are well advised about what is it that we need to be doing. And I think we have an excellent level of engagement. It's something that when I came into post, was struck by. I mean, obviously, it was at a time of COVID, and we would have regular meetings, which were very, very well attended from right across the sector, from right across Scotland. Now, if there are people out there who are suggesting that they don't feel included, I would encourage them to get in touch with me, because I want to hear from them directly about how it is that they are not, or they have the feeling that they are not, because it's important that everybody is included. And I am very keen to hear good ideas from wherever they come. I do feel that I'm well advised. I look very closely at the evidence that you've received from umbrella organisations before the committee, but venues and organisations too. And it is because we are getting good advice that we are committed to what we're doing, both in terms of the increased funding, which we are delivering, is happening, and we hope to be able to strengthen through the budgetary process. But it's also in terms of the wider cultural and arts infrastructure that that I'm keen to make sure that we are delivering that change on.
Just to conclude, just as a comment, if I could, Chair, what we heard, if you go back and look at it, especially last week, was in particular a feeling that in relation to cross-portfolio meetings, that these organisations weren't involved. I think Mr Adam questioned them about that. But the other thing is, just to say, I don't think it was necessarily working groups with particular aims, but it was something which is much more amorphous, which is just a discussion, a chat, meeting at events, things like that, feeling included. I think they have a value in their own right. It's those kind of things. And I'm not certain that many of them, just from having heard their evidence, will take the initiative to contact you. I think it's going to have to be down to the government to say we're going to have this discussion. That's where much of it just is a question of feeling supported and engaged, I think.
Listen, I would encourage anybody for whom that, Mr Brown's description there chimes, please do get in touch. I spend a lot of time going to events with people from the culture and creative sector, and so I very much hope that people feel that I am approachable, that my officials are approachable, that we are very interested in what people have to say. But if there's somebody who feels that they are not, then please get in touch, and we will do our level best to make sure that everybody's voice is heard. And the point about cross-portfolio working is a very good one, and I would wish to give the committee assurance that that happens. An example of that only this week, where I took part in a cross-portfolio meeting in relation to rural Scotland and how the government is delivering right across Scotland. Because as members of the committee and members of the Parliament have made the case before, culture exists right across Scotland, not just in our urban centres or in the biggest events, which often take place in cities, but take place the length and breadth of Scotland, and we need to make sure that we are supportive of that. And that's another dimension to multi-annual year funding, convener, which is that if we and Creative Scotland are able to deliver on all of that, not only will that lead to an increase in the number of organisations that are supported, but it will also lead to a wider footprint of cultural organisations that are funded across Scotland, which would also be a good thing.
I'd just like to thank Mr Brown for raising that issue. It's one I was going to come to as well. In the Parliament today, we have the Illuminate Choir, who will be performing at lunchtime on the theme of Let's Sing Dementia. A perfect example of that community working and culture in the community and the wellbeing economy. And obviously the other part of the funding that comes directly is the opportunity for economic involvement for a lot of the community-based cultural activities. So it is a theme that has come back time and time again, is that embedding of the wellbeing economy and a cross-portfolio embedding of culture. But I would say that we don't have much visibility of that at the moment, Cabinet Secretary, so can you assure us that that work is going on and how you've got difficult budget conversations with colleagues, but this is another one where you'd actually encourage them to look at things like social prescribing?
So the first thing is I was pleased in my opening statement to underscore the value of culture in its own terms, and also recognise the role that it plays in well-being. We don't need to rehearse that in government or in this committee. I think it's very well understood the positive impact that it plays. I think we already have excellent good practice around cultural organisations having a transformational impact in relation to communities. I spent some time not that long ago with Scottish Ballet, learning about what they are able to do in terms of their outreach and their help for different people as part of their well-being. And that level of ambition and outreach that currently happens at the present time in relation to well-being is one that we need to acknowledge. So we're not saying that culture and well-being is something that we think is good and should start. It's happening already, formally and informally. The question is, how can we maximise the potential of that? And that is where there is still progress to be made. But I do know that across government there's a recognition of the advantage that it can and does play. I think one thing in particular that I think there has been acknowledgement of, in particular, is a transformational role that the likes of Sistema has been able to play in a number of communities across Scotland. And it was great to see Sistema performers here, and great to see a growing level of public understanding about their talents, and also the transformational impact that there is in the communities that the musicians come from. So is there more that can be done? Absolutely. But should we acknowledge that there's a lot happening already that others think is worth learning from? And the worth learning from thing is also something that we shouldn't lose sight of. Cultural decision makers in other parts of the world look to Scotland because there is much that is happening here which is worth learning from because of the excellent nature of the sector, notwithstanding the challenges that have been gone through in recent times. Only this week I spoke to a delegation of French cultural decision makers who were here under the auspices of the French Consulate General in Scotland, who were very interested to learn about the culture sector and sustainability, and were being briefed by a number of cultural organisations about what they are doing on that field. So not only is there a lot of good work happening already, others recognise it to be so and want to learn from what's happening in Scotland at the present time.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I've got a final question from Mr. Harvey.
I appreciate the chance, Convener. Very briefly, you did mention, Cabinet Secretary, the Music Venues Trust and the meetings you'd had there. This is a slightly longer-term question than the coming financial year, but if we're reviewing the creative landscape, one aspect of that is diversifying funding sources, and so I think there's some longer-term relevance to it. Hopefully it's just a yes or a no answer I can get to this, because when I raised this idea of the stadium levy, which the Music Venues Trust are arguing could help fund many independent culture venues, your answer was mostly focused on whether it's a devolved or reserved thing, whether it could happen in Scotland or yep. would need to be UK-wide. Can I just get a clear sense of, does the Scottish Government want to see this happen, a stadium levy for that purpose?
So I'm very interested in principle in identifying any funding sources that may be supportive of music venues and organisations in addition to not supplanting public funding. And I made mention of that in my opening statement. I think there's a lot more that can be done in this area. We talk quite a lot about philanthropy as being one particular income source, but there are others, and ticketing is one of those as a potential outcome. Now, this is something that I raised having colleagues, and it was his predecessor on this committee that raised this with great focus, that asked me about it, and I raised it with the last UK Culture Secretary, because as I've alluded to, there are elements to this which are reserved, because it is viewed by some. And this is the area around which we need greater clarity and an understanding of the ability of devolved administrations or working with UK government partners to look at the likes of a ticket levy, because it's viewed as a tax. And we're not going to be able to finalise. I'm trying to give the shortest answer I can. Forgive me.
Wherever the decision-making lies, would the government like to see it happen?
Yeah, I want to see more and diversified income sources. That's not the yes or no that Mr. Harvey would like to see in relation to a ticket levy. I've met the Music Venue Trust. I'd like to meet with them again. I've said to his predecessor, and I would say to him, please, if there are workable models that we can deliver, or we need to work with others to deliver, please talk to us about that, because if there are workable models that provide sustainable additional funding to venues or other organisations, I think we should look at all of them, which is why I'm not going to rule anything out, but I will rule things in on the basis of when I see workable and deliverable proposals.
Thank you, Convener.
Okay. Thank you. Cabinet Secretary, thank you for your attendance this morning, Ms. Rioch as well. And
thank
on
you.
That note, I'll close this meeting of the Parliament.